Welcome to my talk about modern authentication solutions with Angular and OAuth2. My name is Manfred Steyer. I am from Austria. I work there as a lecturer at a University of Applied Sciences. This university is educating part-time, and this gives me a plenty of time to do other things. And I use this time as a trainer and a consultant in the area of software development at iDivisions, which is a German company. From time to time, I write books. My last book is this one. That is the book with the ugliest cover animal. And the book is about Angular.js. I wrote it in German for O'Reilly. Yeah, what are the contents of this talk? First, I want to give a motivation towards the using of OAuth2. I want to show why we need something like OAuth or OpenID Connect. Then I want to give an overview of OAuth2. I want to show you how OAuth2 works from a high-level perspective. Then I will talk about the so-called implicit flow. The implicit flow defines how to use OAuth for a single-page application, like an Angular.js-based single-page application. Then I will talk about OpenID Connect and how OpenID Connect fits in the world of OAuth2. And of course, at the end, I will show you a demonstration that shows how to use OAuth2 within your Angular.js applications. So let's get started. Let's get started with the motivation. As you know, nowadays, every user has to remember a huge amount of user accounts and a huge amount of passwords. And in addition to that, we live in a service-oriented world, and that means that every application needs access to several services. Every application has to access several services in the name of the current user. And the current user don't like it to put in his or her passwords in all these applications, especially if there isn't a strong trust relationship between the user and the applications. Yes, and OAuth2 is one of many techniques that help to prevent these situations. What is OAuth? OAuth has been developed at Twitter and Magnolia, and OAuth is a protocol for the delegation of restricted rights. That means that I could use OAuth to give you the right to post at Twitter in my name. Or I could give you the right to add friends to my Twitter profile in my name. And I can do this without giving you my password. OAuth is quite popular. OAuth has been adopted by companies like Google, like Facebook, like Flickr, and so on. And OAuth defines several flows. A flow is something like a micro protocol. A flow defines which messages has to be exchanged to do authentication and authorization with OAuth. There are some roles. For instance, there is a client. A client is some kind of application, for instance, a native mobile application, a native desktop application, a web application, a single page, or a traditional web application. In addition to that, there is another role. This role is called resource server. A resource server is some server that provides resources, or to put it in a simpler way, a server that provides some services. For instance, HTTP-based services that your application can call. Neither the client nor the resource server wants to have access to user data. Those servers, those instances, don't care for user data. The one instance that cares for user data is the authorization server. And in addition to that, the client is registered at the authorization server. The authorization server knows all the clients, and the authorization server gives every client a client ID, a client secret, that is some kind of password, and something like a redirect URI. The redirect URI is just a URI that points to the client. When it comes to web clients, this redirect URI is the URL of the website. When it comes to native desktop or mobile applications, this URI is an URN, an unique resource name that consists the name of the client in question. In addition to that, the users are also known by the authorization server, and the authorization server also knows the credentials of those users, username and password, and so on. Of course, the resource server is also in connection with the authentication server, but this connection isn't specified by OAuth2. When you look at OAuth from a high-level perspective, everything starts with the client redirecting the user to the authorization server. And at the authorization server, the user has to authenticate him or herself. He or she puts in his or her credentials, and then the authorization server asks the user, "Do you really want to delegate this and that rights to the client? Do you really want that this client has the rights to post a Twitter in your name? Do you really want that this client has the rights to buy books or vouchers in your name?" And then the user says no, and we've done. Or the user says, yes, of course, and the user is redirected back to the client. And as part of this redirection, the client gets a token, a so-called access token. A token is just a string that says that the current client can act on behalf of the user. And when the client accesses the resource server, the client sends over this token, and so the resource server knows, okay, this client can use this and that right in the name of this and that user. The details regarding this communication between the client and the authorization server depends on the flow you choose. As mentioned, there are several flows defined by OAuth, and this flows defines which messages are interchanged here during the communication between the client and the authorization server. The result of this communication is something like an access token. Let's talk a bit about the so-called implicit flow. The implicit flow is a flow that has been designed for single-page applications, and the implicit flow is quite similar to the presented high-level perspective. In the implicit flow, everything starts again with the client redirecting the user to the authorization server. And when the client redirects the user, it transmits some parameters using the query string. For instance, there is a parameter response type with the value token. That means that the client wants to start the implicit flow. For other flows, the response type parameter has other values. Then the client transmits the client ID so that the authorization server knows who the client is. Is that your Facebook client? Is that my Twitter client or something else? And the client also transmits a scope. A scope is a string with space-separated values, and every value in the scope denotes a right the client wants to have from the user. For instance, if your use case is about buying books, the scope could be buy book. Or if your use case is about posting messages at Twitter, your scope value could be publish message. As said, the scope expresses the rights the client wants to have from the user. In addition to that, there is a state. The state is just a value that is passed around. The state is passed from the client to the authorization server and then passed back from the authorization server to the client. You can use this state to keep some state information across these redirections. And there is a redirection URI. This redirect URI is the URI that points back to the client. That is, in most cases, the URL of the client of your web application. After the user has logged in, after the user has accepted that the current client should get some rights, the user is redirected back to the client. And as part of this redirection, the authorization server sends some data to the client. This data is sent back to the client within the hash fragment of the URI. And this hash fragment consists of several key value pairs. For instance, there is a key value pair with the key access token. This parameter contains the access token the client can use to act on behalf of the current user. As mentioned before, the state is passed back to keep state informations across those redirections. And there is also some metadata about the access token. For instance, metadata that gives information about the expiration date of the access token. Expires in says that the access token is valid for this and that amount of milliseconds. There are some things to consider here. One thing is that the client ID has to correlate with the redirect URI. If you transmit the client ID Twitter, you have to transmit the redirect URI for Twitter. If you transmit the client ID Amazon, you have to transmit the redirect URI Amazon. It isn't allowed to transmit the client ID Twitter and to also transmit the redirect URI of your own application, because this would mean that you would get the access token that is created for Twitter or Amazon or someone else. And this is why both the client ID and the redirect URI has to be registered at the authorization server. It is the job of the authorization server to check whether those two parameters fit together. That is one thing to keep in mind. Another thing to keep in mind is that it is a good practice and very, very recommended that you include some nonce into the state. A nonce is a cryptographically safe random string, a string that is passed around. And in addition to that, you should save this string, this random string, within the client. If you use browser applications, you could use the local storage of your browser. When the nonce comes back in the second step, you should check whether this nonce is equal to the nonce that you have stored before. If both nonces are the same, everything is fine. If these nonces differ, then you might be the victim of an attack, of some kind of cross-site scripting attack. So it is really vital to use those nonces and to check those nonces when they come back. That is a second thing you should keep in mind in view of security. When the client has the access token, the client can send over the access token to a resource server, and for that, the client uses the HTTP header authorization. As you might know, this HTTP header normally consists of two values. The first value determines the type of the authentication, and the second value contains some credentials. As authentication type, you use the name bearer, and as the credentials value, you use the token you've got from the authorization server. So ABCDAF is in this case the value of my token. As you've seen before, you can use OAuth to delegate some rights to some clients. So these clients can act on behalf of you, they can act in your name. By design, OAuth2 has nothing to do with single sign-on. By design, OAuth2 has nothing to do with authentication. It deals about authorization, but it doesn't deal about authentication. As OAuth 2 is widely adopted, as there is a huge range of websites accepting OAuth 2, more and more people tend to use, some people say misuse, OAuth 2 for authentication and for single sign-on scenarios. When you want to use OAuth for single sign-on, you have to use a little trick. And the idea behind this trick is that you just request an access token that gives you access to the user's profile. And then you can access the user's profile, and so you can find out who the user is. And in this way, that is something that could be called single sign-on or authentication. You just find out who the user is because you can read the user's profile. There is one problem. The problem is that OAuth 2 doesn't define the structure of this user profile. OAuth 2 is about exchanging tokens. OAuth 2 is about flows that define how the client can talk to an authorization server to get an access token. But OAuth 2 isn't about describing user profiles or the structure used by user profile services. And that's why most vendors use their own vendor-specific format for modeling user data. Google has its own format, Facebook has its own format, and so on. That's quite a pity. And this is exactly where OpenID Connect comes in. OpenID Connect is an extension for OAuth 2. And OpenID Connect defines how to do authentication with OAuth 2. OpenID Connect also defines how to get user profile informations and how this information should be structured. OpenID Connect specifies that the client not only gets an access token, but that the client also gets a so-called ID token alongside the access token. And the IT token is a so-called JVT token. JVT stands for JSON Web Token. So to simplify things, this is just some kind of Base64 encoded JSON data, Base64 encoded JSON data that describes the current user. In addition to that, this JVT token describes also the client the token has been issued for. The guys in the area of authentication and authorization calls those clients the audience. This information shows you who the audience of this token is. That brings some additional security because, of course, my application should only accept tokens that have been issued for my application. If someone comes with a token that has been issued for another application, my application should refuse this token. And this is another security characteristic. Such a JVT token can be signed by the issuer. That means so such a token can contain a digital signature, and so the client can check whether the token is a real token that has been issued by a trusted issuer, or whether the token is a fake token some attacker has created by him or herself. And there are other security characteristics that shuts down some security holes that arises when you use OpenID Connect in the area of authentication. When you use OpenID Connect, everything starts again with the client redirecting the current user to the authorization server. And this redirection is just an OAuth 2 redirection, an OAuth 2 redirection with some additional parameters. For instance, per definition, you have to request the scope OpenID to get an identity token. In addition to that, OpenID defines a separate parameter for the nonce. This parameter is called nonce, so you don't have to use the state to put the nonce forth and back. The answer from the authorization server contains, as showed before, the O of 2 access token. And as mentioned, alongside this access token, the authorization server sends an ID token to the client. And now the client can parse this ID token, look into the token, and find out who the user is. In addition to that, the client can send over the access token to some service to act on behalf of the current user. As an alternative, the client could also transmit the ID token to the service just to prove that the client is acting on behalf of this and that user. You don't need the access token. If the service is able to read and validate an identity token, you can just use the identity token. And there are situations where you don't need the access token at all. In those situations, it is okay to just request the ID token. That is especially true for cases where you use the identity token also to communicate with your server. So let's look at some demonstration. Let's look at a demonstration that shows how you could use O of 2 within your AngularJS application. So here I have a very simple application. This application is about buying vouchers for the current user. And this application uses UIRouter. And there are four menu items. There is the menu item home that leads to this lovely designed welcome page. There is a menu item voucher that leads to a page where you can buy a voucher for the current user. There is a menu item login and another menu item logout. When you click at voucher, the application detects that the current user hasn't been logged in. The application detects that there is no access token for the current user. And so the application forwards the user to the login route. When you look here, you see the user is forwarded to a route that is called login. And as a parameter of this login route, the original requested route is passed. In my case, that is the route voucher. Yeah, and here you have a button login. And when you press this button, you are redirected to an authorization server. This here is an authorization server I created for demonstration purposes. This demonstration server runs within the Azure cloud, as you see here. So, and here you can log in with some username and some password. This demo implementation accepts every username and every password. So this is an implementation for very honest people. So let's in some username and some password. Before I press login, let's have a look at the parameters that have been passed to the authorization server. Here we have one parameter response type with the value token. That's the nodes that we want to start the implicit flow. There is another parameter client ID with the name of my client. Then we have the state. The state is quite long. The state consists of two values. The state consists, in my case, of an nonce, some cryptographically safe random string, a semicolon, and the name of the route the user has requested before. In my case, that route has the name voucher. Yeah, here we have the nonce, quite long, and here we have the voucher route, and I think here we have somewhere an encoded semicolon. Then we have here the redirect URI, that is the URI that points back to the client application, something at localhost as we see here, and index HTML, and here we have the scope that describes the rights the client wants to have, and this scope is called voucher. This value denotes that the client wants to be able to buy vouchers in the name of the current user. So, let's log in for Susan. We are passed back to the application. The application got the access token as part of the hash fragment. The application passed the hash fragment. The application took out the access token of the hash fragment and stored this access token within the local store. In addition to that, the application checked whether the nonce is okay. The application compared the nonce in the hash fragment with the nonce that has been stored into the local store. And then my application transmitted the user to the root voucher, that is the root that the user has requested in the first step. So, and now the application has an access token. And using this access token, the application can request vouchers in the name of the current user. And as you see here, that seems to work. I can buy several vouchers for Susan, and every voucher gets its own voucher code. Let's look inside the source code of this demonstration. My application is a simple AngularJS application within the module demo. And this module imports two other modules, namely the module O of 2 and the module UI router. O of 2 is a module I've written, is a very small module with some directives and some services that just create the URI to which the user is sent for authentication, or a service that just parses the access token out of the current hash fragment. Here in my configuration function, I'm setting up routes. Here I have a route for my homepage, I have a route for my voucher site, I have a route for my login site, and I have a route for my log outside. And perhaps you've noticed it, my route, or let's say my state for my voucher site, has some unusual value. Here I use the value restricted with true. Restricted isn't a value that is defined by UI router. This is just a value that I declared. That is a funny thing around UI router. You can just define your own parameters here, your own properties. You can define what you want and define some values for this and that. That is possible and that is okay for UI router. So I use this mechanism, this extension mechanism, to mark all routes that needs an authenticated user. After that, I have a constant that points to my authentication server, that is located within the cloud. And then I have a run function that configures my OAuth service. My OAuth service gets an RNG URL, that is a URL that points to a service, that is able to create a nonce. It isn't possible with nowadays browsers to create a cryptographically safe nonce. Of course, there is something like the crypto API, but the crypto API is quite young and not implemented within all browsers. So I leverage the server side, I use some service to create a nonce, a cryptographically safe random number. Then the OAuth service gets a login URL. That is the URL that points to the login mask of my authorization server. In addition to that, I set up the redirection URI. That is the URI that points back to my application. And I define a client ID and the scope my client wants to get. In this case, this all is about the scope voucher. Then I set up an event for UI router, and this event is called state change start. As you might know, UI router fires this event before it transitions to another state. And within this event handler, I just check whether the state that is the target of the current transition is a restricted state, a state that I have marked with the property restricted. And in addition to that, I ask my authentication service whether the current user has been logged in. And when the current root is a restricted root, when the current state is a restricted state, and when the user has not been logged in, when the current user don't has a current access token, I prevent the current event. That means I stop UI router from transitioning over to the target state. Then I create a URL that points to the requested target state. In this case, when I request the state voucher, the result of this href function is something like hashtag slash voucher. And then I transition to the login state. This login state just displays a login mask with a button that transfers the user to the login mask of the authentication server. In addition to that, I pass the requested URL that points to the requested state to this login page. Let's have a look at this login page. This is a quite simple page. This page uses a login button, and this login button uses a directive I have written. The name of this directive is OAuth login button. This directive isn't complicated, and I won't dig into the source code of this directive because we don't have enough time. But to be honest, this directive is just vanilla AngularJS and vanilla JavaScript code. This directive just creates an URL that points to the login page of the authorization server. This directive creates a nonce. This directive stores the nonce within the current local storage. And this directive places the created URI that points to the login mask within the on-click handler of this button. That means when the user clicks the button, the user is transferred to this login page. There's nothing magic in here. In addition to that, I define that this value here has to be attached to the state. That means that the directive takes this value, as mentioned before, this value is something like hash slash voucher, and attaches the nonce to it, and this value is used as the state for the current request. So let's go back to my application. When the application is started, my code also calls this try login function of my OAuth service. This function just checks if there is an access token within the hash fragment of the current URL. And if there is some access token, it parses the URL, it parses the hash fragment, and takes out the access token from the hash fragment. In addition to that, this function also takes out the nonce that has been passed back within the state and is currently located within the hash fragment. And furthermore, this function checks the nonce. This function checks whether the nonce from the hash fragment is the same as the saved nonce. And if everything is okay, the access token gets stored within the local storage and this function returns true. And when that is the case, I take the current access token my OAuth service provides, my OAuth service got from the hash fragment, and I put this access token into the custom header authorization. As you might know, when you define a custom header like this one, you have a header that is transferred to every service you call via the HTTP service. And as you see here, I have defined that every call using the HTTP service should use a header authorization with the value bearer and with the value that is the value of my current access token. In addition to that, I check whether a state came back. And when there is a state, this state has the value of the originally requested route, as mentioned, something like /voucher. I stripe off the hash because AngularJS doesn't like this hash. And then I just transfer the user to the originally requested route. So that's all we have to do within here to get use of an OAuth authentication server. There is another thing I have implemented. As you've seen before, in this demonstration, I've used redirections, and that means that the user has to leave the current single page application. That can be okay in some situation. That is perhaps not okay. And for such situations, I have implemented a solution that uses an iframe. To take use of this, you just use another directive, a directive that renders an iframe within the login page and does some JavaScript vanilla codes to interact with this iframe. And in addition to that, you have to use a specific callback URL. Where is it? My callback redirection URL. That is the name of it. A specific callback that is loaded into the iframe and that informs the application outside of the iframe about the received token. This callback is quite simple. It just uses my OAuth service and calls try login, and try login does the rest. Try login parses the URI, try login converts the nonce from the URI with the nonce within the session state, within the local storage, and so on. At the end, try login informs the application out of the iframe about the new access token. So let's start this. Okay. Let's go for a voucher. As you see here, this directive renders this iframe, and now I don't have to leave my single page application to authenticate. Cool. As mentioned before, we don't have enough time to dig into the source code of my services and directives, but there are two points. The one point is the code of these services and directive is very simple. It is just vanilla AngularJS code and vanilla JavaScript code. And the second point is you can find this source code on the web. I have pushed it to GitHub, so you can download it and dig into the source code if you want, or just use the library that I have written. So let's come to the conclusion of this talk. As you've seen, OAuth 2 is about delegating rights. It is not, it has not been designed for single sign-on or authentication. It is just about delegating rights, but it can be used, some people say misused, for single sign-on. When you use single-page applications, you will use the so-called implicit flow. This is the flow that has been designed for JavaScript-based applications, for single-page applications. And you can use OpenID Connect to have a defined way to do authentication with OAuth 2. Here you have my coordinates, and here you see the URL of my GitHub account where you find my sample if you want to dig into the source code or if you want to use this library. So thanks for coming and have a nice day.